Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God, for many false prophets have gone out into the world. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you for allowing me to be here. It's a great honor. Again, God's grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Let me just share just a few things with you. I want to challenge you today to think about. First of all, let me introduce myself again. David Saving. My background is a DCE. For 30 years, I've served in the Luther Church Missouri Synod as a DCE. My heart has always been mission-driven and children-driven and youth. And so these past 5 years, I have been blessed to be the executive director of Children's Christian Concern Society. You can, I'll refer you to our banner up there. There's a couple others in there. And also, before I forget, there's some brochures out there. So if you want to know more details about CCCS, you can grab one of those and get on our website. But we are just simply about reaching children with the good news of Jesus Christ. Our mission statement is to share the love of Christ with children around the world through Christian education. And so that's what we're about. We're in 25 countries around the world, 241 project sites, Lutheran schools that are connected with the National Lutheran Church of those particular countries. And we help support in scholarship, I would say, over 25,000 children in those countries. Now, these children are just, in a sense, just like you and I. You know, if I ask you to raise your hand and say, you know, I'm going to be a famous person, or I am a famous person, probably not too many of us would raise our hands. However, there's good news for us this morning, and my text that I selected to share with you comes from the 15th chapter of St. John, and this is what it says. This is Christ with his disciples, and I want you to see it in that sense that you and I are, if we could transform ourselves back into that day and sit in that room with Jesus, here's what he is calling you and I to be about. He says this in verse 12. He says, my command is this, as you probably well know this very well, love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that he laid down his life for his friends. And then he says this, you are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I have learned from my Father, I have made known to you. And then verse 16 says this, it says, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit that lasts. That's the challenge for you and I to think about. You know, you and I are really just kind of ordinary people, but God has chosen you. That's what we call justification. He has chosen you and appointed you to bear fruit. And what fruit is that? That's a free gift that's been given to us. Even though you and I are ordinary people, we are able to do extraordinary things. I want to bring greetings to you from some ordinary people in Haiti. Matter of fact, in January, I'll be traveling to Haiti. And every time I travel there, they greet me with these words in Creole. Bon divan, tout ton, bon divan, which simply means God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. Now you think about that, that if you understand the situation in Haiti, over the past 4 years, the amount of turmoil that they have been through, earthquakes, famines, 80% unemployment, and I could go on and on, children starving. There's over 86 Lutheran schools in the country of Haiti, and we support some of those. But these are ordinary people who are saying, God is good all the time, but God is doing extraordinary things through them. God wants to accomplish through you and I his extraordinary plan. Do you believe that? That you are going to be doing extraordinary things as everyday ordinary people. Because of the spirit that has been planted in you from that first day of where the water and God's powerful word was engrafted into you, and that you have been chosen in a Braille was one who did that. Back in 1824, Louis Braille, a Christian, invented a system, as you well know, raised dots on paper that blind people could read. He invented 63 symbols representing every language. Hence, God's word was placed into the hands of the visually impaired because of this young Christian man. This idea that he had, he made it come true by the power of the Holy Spirit. Think about communications, and in part we have to owe ourselves to this young Christian man in terms of our mobile, our cell phones, possibly computers. His name was Samuel Morse. If you recall how different the world was before him, it says first class news took 2 weeks to reach the USA, and reports of a major victory took up to 6 weeks to reach Britain. One day, Morris's friend said, "You know, have you ever experienced an absolute deadline in terms of inventing what you did?" And he said, "Of course I did." And he said, "Well, what did you do about it?" He said, "I got down on my knees and I prayed for light, and light came. And when my inventions were acknowledged by flattering honors from America and Europe, I said, 'Unto you, O Lord, not unto me, but unto thy name give the glory,' as Psalms 115 says." I just want to say that I've been where you are right now, sitting in this chapel and wondering, "God, what do you have for me?" And I felt, you know, led by the Holy Spirit to come to Concordia all the way from Kansas. That's where I'm originally from. And our organization is in Kansas still. And sitting here listening to many professors, you know, speak the word of God. And I went on for 30 years being a simple DCE in 4 or 5 congregations and did my thing. Wonder, did I really touch youth and children and adults in those congregations with the love of Christ? And that's not for me to know. But being an ordinary person just like you, God has a plan for you, and are you willing to step out of the boat as Peter did? To open up your box that we live in and that we are comfortable with, as Peter did, and said, "Okay, Lord, I'll follow you. I'll keep my eyes on you." 5 years ago, I had the opportunity as a simple DCE to experience an opportunity to become the executive director of this small, humble organization. And it's because this organization started 44 years ago, by a simple young farm boy in Southwest Kansas. His name was Jim Jorms. He's now a doctor and retired. But he said, "Lord, use me. I want to bear fruit that will last." And so he packed up his bag, his young family, and moved to the country of Guatemala for 3 years. And it was simply just an agricultural missionary. He tried to teach them how to grow their corn and their maize in a better way. And then through that, he noticed that small children in the remote villages not having an opportunity to get an education. And one time he took his family to the Eastern Caribbean shoreline and met a young girl, 8 years old. And through that relationship, he invited her to come and live with them in this small village called Zacapa, Guatemala, where there was a Lutheran school. And she lived with them for 2 years. She began to get an education, a Lutheran education, Christian education. And now, as the story goes this way, a simple, ordinary man does extraordinary things through the Holy Spirit. And this young lady, 8 years old, now is 52 years old. She was what we can call our first sponsored student, Gloria Gachura. She met her husband at this Lutheran school